Joe, though, I want to welcome one of the greatest in the game. He's underrated, even though I know you don't like the word, but it's true. You got to recognize that this man should be right up there with all them right now. I'm not even lying.
I appreciate
one of the
that.
The nicest in the game, man. I am Sue, Sports and Hip Hop with DJ Mad Max, iHeartRadio Live 365. I am Sue. How you doing tonight, man?
I'm great. That was a hell of an intro, so I'm feeling great.
Enjoying your life, enjoying the new project, California Deluxe.
Yes, sir. Loving it, bro. Loving it, bro.
No auto. You showcase your lyrical ability on that. That's the Sue. That's the Sue in you.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what people be wanting. I just, I'm such a creative person. I be turning that auto tune on and just reaching for new levels. But you know, every project, these last three, I'm like, I got to give them straight bars, no auto tune. Just go as long as I could go. So I'm gonna make sure I had that on every single project and just try to come with some little clever lines here and there.
You got a song for every crowd now. When you go out to New York, the song I just mentioned, No Auto, is something that New Yorkers would love because they like that real hip hop lyrical stuff. You go out to California, they like the chill stuff. The Bay Area, of course, we know HBK. How is it performing out in different areas and having such a buffet of different songs that they could match each vibe?
It's dope. It's dope. I got a lot of love, like especially you speak of New York. I did a bunch of shows in New York, like all the way back. So I think the venue is called like Santos Party House or something like that. Yeah, so I rocked over there. I performed in Brooklyn. I performed at another music hall. I think Jay-Z did his B-sides there, but I forget the name right now. But it's like a three-level music venue. It's in Manhattan. You know what I'm talking about?
Okay, I probably know what it is. Yeah, I just can't think of it.
Jay-Z did his B-sides there.
I've been to a bunch of them.
Music hall. Yeah, so I love New York, and I do kind of adjust my shows depending where I'm at. So like you said, Kelly, I could relax. I know most people are going to know most songs, but New York, I feel like I need to go extra hard. Like Detroit, I feel like I need to really wrap my ass off in Detroit. Yeah, so just different places, it's different flavors.
Mm-hmm. What crowd was the most tough on you as far as wanting a different sound? Because I've heard stories of artists going to New York and they were playing their stuff that were for a different crowd and they were like, give me the bars. Was that New York for you?
Nah, hell nah. New York was rolling with me.
Yeah.
Energy, like they brought that energy. We was partying in New York. I can't lie. But my toughest crowd, where I was just like, damn, I didn't know what to do, it probably would be Detroit. Detroit, I had to, like, they was enjoying the show, but I really feel like I had to sell that music while I was up there. I really felt like I had to just, you feel me? Had to go in. So.
And that's what you did, 100%. But I'm from the 5 and the 10. That's a good one.
For sure. Yeah, repping the crib. You know, that area code, it gets repped, but I feel like not a lot of rappers will be claiming a 510. You know what I'm saying? So I feel like I wanted to give a little detail about where I'm from and just show, like, the cool parts of it. Like,
yeah, stay humble. That's something that you obviously are. Why is it so important for you to stay humble in this game?
Man, because I see what happens when you're not humble and from personal experience, not even pointing a finger at nobody. When I try to feel myself too much, I crash out. So I just try to stay humble.
So there were times where you weren't humble and you realized just learning from experiences that it's better to stay grounded?
Yeah, and I crashed for sure. Yeah.
But you're not crashing anymore. You're still releasing material. How are performances go with this new project? You've been able to have any opportunities? I know the pandemic has some weird clauses on certain places.
Yeah, so I mean, shows have opened up all year, but I decided that I was going to kind of take a step back. But recently, I've been performing. So I performed at the Millennium Tour in Oakland. Lloyd brought me out. And then I just performed at Day in Vegas Festival last weekend. So I'm like popping up here and there. So 2022, I plan on getting back out there and just doing my thing. Mm-hmm.
Well, let's start from the beginning now. Tell me about your life story of growing up in Richmond, California.
Yeah. So that's where I was born. I was born in San Pablo at Brookside Medical Hospital. So like in and around Richmond as a youth, I went to Pinole Valley High School, CC College. My first jobs were at elementary schools and junior high schools. I was an after school program teacher. So that was like all the kids know me and my mom. You know, my mom's a teacher as well. So all the kids know me as Mr. Williams. You feel me? Those like
kids were bad to you too. They didn't listen to you.
Man, they was hyphy. Yeah, they was hyphy back in the day, but we grew a bond. So I'm still cool with a lot of them students right now, and they be supporting my music and stuff. So I was telling them I was going to be rapping way back then. So they was just super proud. Mm-hmm.
You started when you were 14. I know some of your major influences include Kanye West, R. Kelly, Aaliyah, Marching Band. Those are some of your major influences. And I think that you get the Kanye West and R. Kelly influences in music because you can also produce your music.
R. Kelly is sensitive, but yeah. Kanye West, for sure. My first email was Sudanye West at Yahoo.
Oh, that's fire.
So yeah, I love Kanye. I love Kanye from day one. I played College Dropout on my CD player with bass boosts. I had to buy that CD probably like 3 different times because I just played it out with Lose It. I played College Dropout so I couldn't play it no more. So Kanye West definitely at the top of my list, just overall style, music, just how he does his thing. I love Kanye West.
Being a fan of Kanye West, how do you feel about his sound changing over time? I get that artists and producers grow over time. They change their sounds, but you mentioned College Dropout, then you got Graduation and his legendary albums. Then you get to Yeezus and then you get to Life of Pablo. Mm-hmm. How are you feeling about how his sound changed up, especially with Donda?
Yeah, I'll just put my seatbelt on. And then like after the first couple of changes, like the first 3 albums, I feel like we're kind of in alignment with each other. Like he built a brand with those, but when he went 808s and Heartbreaks, I was just like, wow, it was just like brave, you know? And that's what led me to be like, let me cut the auto-tune on. I was already feeling auto-tune, but once he really went on one with that one, it just had me like super inspired to take more risk.
Mm-hmm. Backflip was a song that you produced for Casey Veggies. That was huge.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. And that was a fun night. It was out there in LA. BET Awards weekend, like 2014. So my album, Sincerely Yours, came out in May. And I was still just on a promo run because the BET Awards are in June. So got the opportunity to go to the awards with Sage. My manager at the time, Stretch, gave me his ticket. And so I go to the BET Awards. I'm super juiced off of that. Then I go to the studio that night. And then Casey pulls up and we make Backflip right on the spot.
Became a hit. And was this when you realized that, man, I could be a hit producer because I'm not only producing my own tracks that are going off, but other people's?
For sure, for sure. And like, in addition to Kanye, I always look to people like Pharrell, you know, just like those producers that will also feature on a song and like bring life to the song. So that definitely was a bag. I'm like, for sure, you know, I'm like, this is something I could always do. If I don't want to just be the main artist, I could always produce and write.
I know you were sending music to Tyga too. You were sending him.
Yeah, me and Tyga got a couple songs.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got a couple songs.
Have you talked with him any further about producing anything in the future with him?
I've been super reserved with producing for people. Yeah. Like, I've just been kind of making songs for myself, kind of almost in like a J. Cole type of bag. Like, I'm going to just make my music kind of insulated. But like moving forward, I'm definitely open to work with everybody.
Who's someone that once you're ready, that you're really tapped in with to working with? Who you haven't worked with yet because you've worked with a ton of people?
Somebody that I would really want to work with right now? Mm-hmm. Probably... it's always Future, for sure. But I would say, like, right now, it'd probably be Gunna. I feel like me and Gunna make something super hard.
Tough. That'll mm-hmm. be tough. I could see that happening.
Yeah, like melodies, some guitars, just going crazy. Mm-hmm.
How does it feel that you finally overcame Up? Because Up was that hit song where it's all you can't get over that hump, but you did.
Man, I that means a lot because that was like my life's mission at one point was to overcome that. Like, because I'm like, man, I'm an artist for real, bro. Like, I got so much more to offer than that. Not even taken away from that song, but I'm just like, I got so much more to offer to music than that. I'm just like, damn, like, so it just took like so much music and just so many different like narrative changes and me feeling like, oh, I really got to tell my story, even when people maybe didn't want to hear it. So it just took a lot of that. Well, it was like a time where I could have just fully cashed in on an up sound and just made a trillion ups, but I was like more interested in music, like really making different types of music.
Mm-hmm. Up, like I said before, you were able to overcome that. It's almost always similar to Nas with Illmatic because he's always talking about, man, I'm tired of Illmatic. I'm tired of hearing about it because look at all the other albums he's made. It Was Written,
right.
I Am, Stillmatic. Those albums don't get right. as much praise. And to me, I think It Was Written was a better album.
See, I need to visit that. But when I start, I listened to Illmatic, and then like I start getting into Nas. Probably it was like Stillmatic, Godson, Streets Disciple.
Godson's a great
that
album.
I was like listening to Nas, like the N Word, I think it was called. Mm-hmm. So like that whole phase, that whole like after that shorty, like after that time, that's when I start really tuning into Nas, like giving his releases a chance every time.
As far as lyricists go, who do you admire most? Because we've heard you on your song, especially with No Auto, where you're just going in on some type of Big L type of flow.
Oh, man. Like, lyricists, mm-hmm. number one is Lil Wayne. Lil Wayne is, like, my biggest rapping inspiration. I used to really rap like him. Like, mm-hmm. you know, and I just really appreciate, like, I'll be listening to stuff right now and be like, damn, that's what that meant. Like, you know, I'll be catching lines, like, 10, 12 years later, like, oh, you know what I'm saying? So Wayne, for sure. Let me try to think of somebody that's just super nice that nobody would normally say. I like G Herbo. Like, if we're talking about straight bars. Mm-hmm. Benny the Butcher, for sure.
He signed with Snoop Dogg, too.
Yep. I'm trying to think, and it's like one more person. I'm going to put Jadakiss and Lloyd Banks.
Ooh. Either one. That's tough. Yeah,
Lloyd like Banks was like definitely, I used to love Lloyd Banks. The way he put them punchlines together, he was too crazy.
Hunger for More.
Mm-hmm.
Hunger for More too.
Yeah, for sure. Shouts out to Lloyd Banks, to the whole G Unit. They showed me hella love.
Rotten like Apple?
Early on. Yeah, that Rotten Apple album for sure.
Yeah.
That was a sleeper.
It was. Not everyone was on that one.
Yeah, but it has some bangers on there.
It did, especially for real hip hop heads, and you can tell just through your music that you appreciate the lyricism and the art of hip hop, because there's an art to this. Whereas though, social media has kind of just disbanded it, where people just throw out anything out there and they feel as though it's good and it could be a masterpiece. But you're kind of like that artist from the last generation. Like when you think about the 2013s, the 2014s, after that generation, you didn't see too many artists that really made it in that way. You kind of came out. You didn't really come through the social media way per se, right. just staying totally attached to social media. You get what I'm saying?
Absolutely. Yeah. I talk about that with the homies sometimes. It was like, we low-key the last generation of 106 and Park and like radio freestyles and stuff like that. So where it was like, we had to kind of touch the people a little bit more. And like nowadays, I feel like social media is beautiful because it's helped me in my career so much, but it's just different.
Yeah. 100%. And those 106 and Park days, I wish we could get back there. The Rap City basement days.
Man, but I'll go in there and flame some right now.
Oh, man. But I really enjoyed hearing the rappers that you admire as far as lyricists go. But we got to get into your other work. And at 14, you started music. You were experimenting with different instruments. What was in your starter kit as far as instruments go?
My drum set and my piano. Well, not my piano, my grandparents' piano. And then my laptop, or really my Dell desktop at first. That's where I started making beats on. It was this program. It wasn't even FL Studio. It was like Wave Edit. It was like Wave Edit. And I would take a bunch of different clips from a bunch of different songs. Mm-hmm. And I was like, okay, I got this snare from Dr. Dre, Let Me Ride. I got this loop from this song and this. And I would just try to match it up. And I would literally copy and paste every sound, like put the clicks and the claps and the kicks in place. And once I get like a 2-bar or a 4-bar loop, I'd just copy that hella much. And those were like my first beats. And then it went to FL Studio, then Reason, which I use now.
Reason. And how is that? How's that been, that transition to Reason? Because with technology changes over the years, especially as a real producer, not someone that just goes on an app and does what they do and drops it on SoundCloud.
Man, Reason has been awesome because it's like it keeps evolving. There's a lot of producers that be like off of Reason because it looked hella old school. But I just got Reason 12 or 13, whichever the newest one is. And it's like, it got all the capabilities. And this is not a commercial. I don't work for them, but
no.
They got the pitch bending. They got the VSTs. They got the fire sampler now. It's like, so Reason is doing what it needs to do for sure.
100%. And we got to get into your rapper name. So you changed it for, is it search engine purposes? Was that what it was for? That's why you really changed it?
I mean, once everything was really making sense, yes. So at first it was just Sue, and we'd be trying to search my name, and it would be like everything but me. And then my Twitter would come up sometimes, but I noticed every time I searched my Twitter name, it would come up. So I want to credit DJ Slowpoke because he hosted my mixtape, T-Minus, and he was like, I just want to keep calling this man by his Twitter name, which was I Am Sue. And then that eventually just became my name because, like you said, search engine and all that stuff.
How'd you deal with the popularity and the fame at such a young age in high school? Because you were getting on these huge tracks, Function, Gas Pedal. How'd it feel because you were in high school?
It was after high school.
It was after high school. Okay.
But I was like 21, 22. So it was like crazy. I don't know. I was like, everybody was saying I was hella oblivious, but that was like, I was always just on the way to the next. The reason why I would just be like not so caught up in the song is because I'm like, what's the next song? Oh, okay, that's cool. People be calling me like, damn, Gas Pedal blowing up, bro. Like, whoa. And I'd be like, on to Making Kilt 2, or you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So the way my mind work is like, I'd be appreciating the win, but then it's like, now what? You know what I'm saying? Like, once the high, you reach that high, then it's like, now what? You know? So that's what that was. But then that time was insane. It seemed like every day it was somebody like big hitting my DMs or something. It was always a show to pop out at. It was always a verse, somebody trying to buy a verse or a beat all the time. So it was just like crazy. And we just stayed traveling. Like, we would just be mobbing to LA hella much, gang deep. We all in two rooms, like 12 folks, just living that early rapper life that I see the new guys do. And it's like real cool to see the cycle continue.
Tell me, how was the studio session for Function, especially being in working with the legendary E-40?
So how it went was he sent me the song when I was in LA at my girlfriend at the time's house. And we was like, looking at each other, like the way it sounded, we was like, what? And she was like, do it. As soon as you get back to the Bay, do it. So I was kind of sick and stuff, but I banged it out. I had lost my voice. That's why my voice sounded like that. So I was at my boy Chief house. He had this fat ass sub. And I remember he was just slapping the song and stuff. And I just went in. I'm like, I'm finna rap. Like, this is my last time I'm finna rap. Like, I just went in on that thing.
But it's important that you were able to work with E-40, because someday I did hear you say that you want to be mentioned in the same breath as E-40 and Too Short. You want to make sure that you have that impact.
1,000%. Yes. Because to me, their longevity, their independence, their consistency, you know, their business moves outside of music. That's what I really would like to be in that class. You know, E-40 is Scorpio, so his birthday the day before mine.
That's right. Oh, so your birthday just passed then.
Yeah, November 16th,
2022. Yeah, because E-40's birthday was just here, and happy belated to you. What did you do for your birthday?
Thank you. I went to Vegas. So when I was talking about the Day in Vegas festival, that was like a part of my birthday weekend. So I just had like went to a couple dinners, performed at the festival, and then I went to the Raiders game, which was super lit.
How you feel about the Raiders being in Vegas now?
It broke my heart when they first left, but now that I see that stadium, it makes sense.
Because it took away their, in my opinion, their tough persona. When you think of the Raiders, you think of Oakland. They're this rough, yeah, tough team. Now they're out here and they're like, they became rich.
Yeah, they came super rich. And yeah, it was so many Chiefs fans. It's like, it's no home field advantage over here because everybody comes to Vegas. Like Oakland, yeah, people come, but people's coming to Vegas every single minute. So that stadium was packed with people that I don't even know if they even cared about the game. They was just in there getting drunk.
Were you a Raiders fan? Because you mentioned that you were heartbroken.
I mean, I guess so. I'm like not the biggest football fan ever. I've been to a Niners game, and I know I'm not a Niners fan, so I'm a Raiders fan.
How about for basketball? Who's your team?
Basketball's the Lakers.
The Lakers? How you feel about that LeBron play last night, and he only getting suspended one game?
I mean, he get preferential treatment just because, you know, it's his league still. But that was nasty how the dude's face looked after.
Yeah, Stewart.
Could have been like 5 or 6 games, you know what I mean, and a huge fine, but he said it was unintentional, so you know what I mean. But it was crazy. I think they had to show that toughness though, because they just thinking that we soft out here.
Yeah. Malice at the Palace. It looked like there was going to be a part two if it escalated. If Stewart got to LeBron, there might have
oh,
been.
Oh, yeah. They would have been scrapping, but Russ was ready. I don't know if you saw that meme.
Russ was ready. They were holding him back.
Yeah.
That's a total meta world peace move by LeBron. I would say meta world peace's move was worse when he elbowed James Harden, if you can recall that play.
Oh, yeah.
Man. But it reminded me of that, and that's when Meta was on the Lakers.
Yeah, something about that Laker uni. You might have to just throw some bows around.
Congratulations on starting your own label, too. Eyes on me. Yes, sir. You decided to create this because you didn't want to deal with these big labels. They were jerking you, and you said, why am I going to join a big label? Because I bought myself two Benzes. I have a house. Yeah. I have chains. I've been overseas. What's the point of a big label?
Man, especially at that time, and I was entertaining partnerships, like, at that time, but it's just definitely has been a blessing to have my own label and just retain this ownership of my music and also do things like upload my album 2 days before it drops, like, just be making songs and be like, okay, I'm dropping right now. So having that freedom and not having to fit into a mold is, like, one of the big benefits of being independent.
Do you see that in a way that these major labels are eventually, they're going to change in a way to even, I wouldn't say they're ever going to disappear, but you see artists such as yourself going independent. Do you see that being the major thing now? Just artists just strictly going independent? Because you'd be surprised about the major artists you see in the game. Fat Joe's independent. There's major artists who are independent.
I think it's always going to be a space for us, but it's always a new guy ready to sign. It's just like I feel like it was a rock and roll video a long time ago, and it was a bunch of kids going into the grinder. I don't know if it was like Pink Floyd or something. It was just like, but anyway, my reference means this. It's always going to be somebody new to sign on that dotted line. So I don't think they going nowhere no time soon, just because the allure of like fame and fortune and instant success might outweigh long term to some. But it's a lot of people getting hip too, so I think it's like 50-50.
Yeah, labels are just insane, because even though you see these rappers out here that are great lyricists, and you see Dave East could be one of them, they don't promote their artists that they sign either, and then you get shelved, and you can't shelf yourself once you're independent.
You can't shelf yourself. It's your work ethic, bro. You should put that on a t-shirt. You can't shelf yourself. But yeah, like, it's really just your work ethic. That's what it all boils down to. So independent ain't for everybody. You have to front the bill and you have to be down to work. So if you're not into putting your own money up, and if you're not into potentially taking an L, or you're not dedicated on being in that studio. So it's like, just as much as you care about rapping, you got to care about your release strategy and all this stuff, which is cool for me just because I'm on my phone all day anyway. So I just be looking at different artists, how they go about their rollouts, how they go about their investments and stuff. And I just, things I like, I pick from here and there, everywhere, and just adapt.
Who are some of those artists that you've studied in which you're picking certain things out?
Yeah, so many, bro. It could go from like Uzi and Aiden Ross stream. So it's like, okay, everybody's hopping on the Aiden Ross stream. Or it could be like Moneybagg Yo and Thug buying land in their states, you know, and like stuff like that. Or Russ dropping that book, you know, or it could be a whole bunch of different things. I saw Murder Beats drop the sound kit. Like, just things within music that's like different types of thinking that's still, like, feel me? You can run it up off of different little things like that, like a how-to book with Russ. I know he ran it up off of that. Like, just different ventures into where you don't always have to tour. You don't always have to drop an album. It's just, like, more tangible products and just assets. And I like stuff like that.
Something that's amazing about you is that you have these hits that you've had in the past come back, and then they keep going platinum and they keep going viral. Isn't it insane?
Yeah. Bro, it is insane, bro, because I'm like, it just seemed like the songs won't die. Like, for instance, like, Up just started going viral on TikTok, like, last year.
I saw,
like,
that.
Super viral. And then Famous went super viral. I was like, dang, like, all the blogs, like, a million plus TikTok videos, which I guess is, like, going platinum. You feel me? So a million people did something. It's like, they was changing clothes. So I'm like, wow, that's crazy. And then Yeah, bro. Like, even a Soldier Walk to an extent was cool to just put that out and, like, just see what people did to it. When I first posted that dance, I was like, this might flop. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. I got hella videos of people doing it, and I was just like, wow.
Yeah. You're a big listener.
So it was like a social experiment low-key.
Yeah, it really is, and it's amazing how these songs just come back and be hits, as I said before. It would be interesting to see other artists do that, and you really don't see too many other artists that they come back and just take over the viral scene again. It's very rare to see that.
It's very rare. Yeah, so I'm grateful about that, and that's just why I started releasing hella more music. Like, right in the moment when that was going up, I probably dropped, like, 40 songs, and then even going into this year, it's just like, let me drop more and more music, you know?
How did COVID change your life for the better, even though it was a negative time and we're still going through it?
Man, it just made me focus. That was number one. It made me sit still, which is number two, which I really needed to do. I started eating at home, so it wasn't no Popeyes and pizza and Hennessy and stuff. So I start like moving better. I got way healthier. And I picked up hella more skills, like, within music and also just like life skills, like painting and gardening and just different little stuff. So coronavirus was a necessary break for me. Yeah, I would say, like, aside from the negative things, I'm grateful for that time to just focus up.
It sounds as though a lot of artists changed their ways and got better during the whole quarantine process and COVID. And that's great to hear. But you're a huge listener of Uzi, Meek Mill, Mike Sherm, Drake,
yeah.
Some of the artists that you're listening to right now. Who do you think is on the rise right now? It could be from your area, because I know you're in Atlanta and in California right now. So who's someone that you see on the rise that could be making the next impact out here?
Sofego, for sure. Ken Carson, SSG Kobe, Capolo. Lim West, Fabes, he's from the Bay, going crazy. So many people. Kalen for real, he's so fire to me. It's hella, bro. It's hella. Yeah. I could name probably like 25 people right now. I listen to so much new music.
Have you thought about signing any of these artists, if they're not signed already, or any artists that you're looking at now that you have your own label?
I'm down to produce an artist. I'm not necessarily looking to really sign anybody, but I would love to just have somebody get down with the click and just produce for them and game them up on how to move through the industry. But as far as like getting them on a 5 albums for this, I ain't trying to really control nobody's career like that, because I'm still an artist. And I always see, like, when people sign an artist, it don't always work out.
Mm-hmm. Do you still listen to your music in the 06 Solera?
Nah, I ended up getting a new car, but
you got a new car.
I wish I would have kept that because the sound system in that car, stupid slap. I love the preview songs in there because it would be slapping 3 hard, and it gave me a vibe. Like, that car was like a super vibe. Did so much in that car.
Yeah, how does the music sound in your new car? Is it the same or no? Not really. It's a newer car, but the sound system just isn't the same as it was.
The sound system ain't the same. It's loud, but it ain't that. It ain't that, though. The Toyota has so much bass. It's just a vibe. I don't know. I can't describe it. Like, it was just a vibe, bro.
Let's talk about your track in 2020 that you released during the protests that were going on, the George Floyd. Mm-hmm. Things for the people. What was going through your mind when you wrote this track? Because it was you were hinting at the struggles that you were going through and finding success, and even when you're gone, which you were hinting at retirement and many, many years to come.
Oh yeah. So that was just an emotional time. I wrote that as a poem at first, and I was just gonna share it on social media. But I ended up rapping it. And it was super emotional. It was super emotional for me to do that. Like I don't usually talk like political, you know what I mean? But it was just so much going on. And also with feeling trapped too. So it was like, all I can use is my voice. And I'm like, I'm gonna look back on this time and regret it if I don't say nothing, you know? So I'm like, I had to say something.
And it was important that you did, especially the times we're going through in which you can apparently just get away with murder with an AR-15 and claim self-defense.
Yeah.
And
that's true.
That's a great thing. It's just, I really don't understand that. The Black Neighborhood and the Brave Area are two things that you've participated in as well, especially in 2020.
Yeah, you hit. Yeah, for sure. Black Neighborhood. That's my boy Royce and company, Corey, all those good guys down there in Richmond, and they just did a turkey giveaway, I believe yesterday. So yeah, they do great things out here in Richmond and beyond, all over. I think they got events like out of state as well. So definitely the Black Neighborhood, some I'm definitely behind.
Mm-hmm. The important things that you support and which people need to recognize, and if they do, I'm sure they're tuned in. We got to get into Yay Area and working with Lil Jon.
Yeah. So
legend,
that's
the crunk
that
legend.
Goes into that convo we was talking about with E-40 and Too Short. So one thing I really noticed, like, that was a pivotal part of their careers when they made the choice to work with him. I saw like a reinvention in their careers and like more mainstream. So I'm like, if I got the opportunity, I'm hopping on it. So I just went on Twitter. It was like, I'm trying to work with Lil Jon, and he hit me right back. He's the coolest dude ever. We've been locked in ever since. Texting all the time. He came to the Bay, came to the club with him. We're working on more music. So we just built a cool relationship, and we both live in the same area in Atlanta. I just found out. So when I get back to Atlanta, I'm definitely going to get in with him some more.
That's fire. Could we see a collaboration tape? Because I know you've worked with Problem. Could we see a collaboration tape between you two possibly?
I would love that. Yeah. I would love that. I mean, he wants me to help him work on some stuff he has going, but if we could bang out a little 6-7 songs, man, that'd be 3 hard.
Oh, that's tough. That's,
yeah, that'd be legendary. You just flip some old songs too.
Yeah, that would be amazing for you. Legendary in the books. But I got to get into this song, By My Side. That's,
yes, sir.
That song was crazy.
Yeah, for sure.
You see
for
that
sure.
In the comments. That, and that just goes to show you. That goes to show you, too, when you see in the comments, is people are saying that this is just, that's a hit. And you really know how to structure a song. Just by listening to that song, you know how to structure it because you come in with the hook, you come in with the verses. Crazy.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, I made that song in Hawaii, and it was just like such a vibe on that trip. I just went and just banged that out in one session, and everybody in the studio was geeked. We played that song so many times after I recorded it. We just kept running it back like, dang, boy. Like, so I'm just glad that the people felt it, because it wasn't no stimulus package behind that. It wasn't really no money invested into that song. It was just like uploaded. And then people just reacted naturally. So all them views, ain't no bought views, ain't no bought streams. It was just support. But a main thing that really helped it was a challenge. So I put the instrumental up, and then like thousands of people submitted videos, and I was just posting them, and I was just building a song up hella much.
That's something you mentioned today too, that you really didn't have back then, and you couldn't fake it. These artists, they buy all their views and all these likes, and that's really ruining the game, because the artists that are really doing numbers, they're being outweighed by the ghost likes and the ghost numbers.
Yeah, so like a real 150,000 views is honestly a lot. Like if it's just normal, organic 150,000, but when you put the grease on it, that'll turn into 5 million. You know what I'm saying? So it's just, I don't really trip off the pumped up numbers. I just know good music is going to last and it's going to spread. So I just stick to my guns.
Yeah. Let's talk about your songs up. Just keep going viral. That's not going to happen. You know what I mean? For these artists that are out here faking like that, it's not going to happen.
Yeah, if you're faking, no. But it's a lot of good music out here. So
yeah,
it's good music. Definitely still going around. Mm-hmm.
Kill 3, Million Dollar Afro. You have some amazing bodies of work here, working with Problem. Man, when did you form your relationship with Problem?
Problem came like, by way of my managers at the time. Like, he came to the Bay and did some shows. We was just supporting him, kicking it with him. And then all of a sudden, it was like, yeah, y'all need to do a mixtape. Like, ooh. So we just put the mixtape together. But it was just so happened that Problem is one of the coolest people ever, you know? So we was just kicking it. That became, like, my big brother. Anything in L.A., he was just making sure I was right. And we just banged that album out, and I would love to do another one before he retired, because I know he keeps saying he's going to retire from rap.
Yes, he always says that.
Which part. I don't think he needs to do. I think he needs to stick around.
Yeah, it's no, cool up here. You never really retire. Jay-Z retired back in the late 90s, and that hasn't happened.
Still right.
You can't. Once you're invested in this music career, you really can't. Because it's your labor of love, and eventually you're going to get in the back of that booth, because you're going to see other people moving forward. And because if you're seeing it right now, Nas and Jay-Z going at it in the early 2000s there, Nas is running New York hip hop as far as the legend standpoint go with KD and KD too. He's going crazy. So I'm curious to see when Jay-Z is going to get back in here and try to be like, you know, it's my turn to take this throne back.
Yeah, I would love Jay-Z to just put out an album like on some Hove type vibes. Yeah. Like he gave us the 444 vibes. I would love to hear Hove vibes. Yeah. Like, I'm the biggest, baddest ever, guess, you know, craziest beats. You know, like, you've been around for a long time. I'm sure some of your producer friends is keeping their best beats in the Jay-Z folder. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I would love to see him get on that.
I need to see you on a track with The Game here.
That would be hard. I ain't gonna lie. You know, The Game was literally, like, one of my favorite rappers. Like,
documentary.
Man,
the Red Album,
Doctor's Advocate,
and Kanye did some production on there as well. He was on a
Early on, first album. And I remember like all the Black Wall Street, like my boy, who's also my neighbor, like my childhood friend Brandon, he had all the unreleased Black Wall Street, like all of it, bro. So before Game's album was called, the documentary, I think, was called NWA or something like that, and he was having all the leaks, like AOL first listens, mixtapes. I think the DJ's name was New Jersey Devil, so he was just having hell of that.
The Game. Now, he's someone that's underrated. I know you don't like that word, but that's word I use because you got to put it out there because this guy should be getting more flowers than he is. You know what I mean?
The Game is a problem. Like, that 300 bars, I don't think anybody's ever done that
since then.
He guessed that, man, 50 for 300 bars. It was like 16 minutes. Like,
yeah.
He went in, bro.
Insane. And he dropped 92 bars against Meek Mill there. The Game is someone that you don't want beef with.
Yeah, because he is going to ride that shit until it don't exist. Yeah. He's going to go in about some beef, bro. But yeah, The Game, definitely a legend, multi-platinum. Like, he's one of them ones, especially as far as California goes. He broke barriers, you feel me? So I tip my hat to The Game.
I was reading online somewhere that 50 Cent was featured on one of the remixes that you produced.
Yeah, 50 Cent hopped on up. When Rand signed to Interscope, 50 was incorporated, and that's how they shot the big video. And then we made another song that never got officially released. It's called Show You.
Ooh. But yeah, tell me the story behind this. Were you actually in the booth with 50 Cent making this song too?
No, never in the booth with 50, but me and 50 was tapped in for like a cool period of time. Like, we would talk on the phone. I saw him in person a few times, and he played a mentor role. He talked to me a lot when I was going through early rap game stuff.
What were some of the things that he told you? Because this is a moment right here for you and your fans to find out what the conversations were like with 50 Cent as being a legend.
Man, it was crazy. He talked to us on the phone for like 4 hours. Like 4 hours. It was crazy. I'm like, dang, like, and he was just sharing like he liked our organic music, like how we came with like a back and forth. He said he really liked our call and response songs. We had another single called Swaggin', and he was just like, everybody can get with that. He was just like giving us props, and he was hip. So I thought he was hella cool. He lived up to the expectations, like, you know, get rich or die trying, like, you know what I'm saying, and like what that meant to everybody. So being able to just have a conversation with him was crazy.
Huge. And just think about it, his sophomore album, The Massacre, some people even say is better than Get Rich or Die Trying. That's how great The Massacre was.
Yeah, The Massacre had bangers on it. That Baltimore Love thing was crazy. It's a lot of bangers on there.
Insane. What do you think is your masterpiece of an album or project that you've released thus far? What is your Get Rich or Die Trying?
And my masterpiece right now is Sincerely Yours. Sincerely. I think that's my best album. Most complete album, best production, just the whole nine.
Kill 3, that's another one too.
Oh man, yeah, Kill 3 was hard, bruh. Yeah, I could see that too. Yeah, that was hard. So, I mean, either one of those, just because I'm just going off a scale of production, lyrics, impact. But Kill 3 and Sincerely Yours was like right on the same level to me. So,
yeah, those are your two. That's your Get Rich or Die Trying and Massacre right there.
For sure.
Yeah.
For sure. I remember I was in New York when Kill 3 dropped, and that was just hella special to me. It was like kind of ceremonious because like I dropped my Sincerely Yours album on Warner Brothers, went through that process. When I was finally independent, I'm still in a Warner Brothers office because I had been signed to a publishing deal as well. So I would be in a studio still. But that album came out in the same office that I was signed to, that same building. It was just like surreal, like, wow, like this is my first independent album. And just looking out the window at Times Square and stuff. Like, you know, the Warner building, I don't know if you've been there. It's like right in the middle of Times Square.
I know where it is, yeah.
Yeah, so like being in there, looking around, I'm just like, wow, like, you know, this is a milestone.
Yeah. HBK, we got to get into this. Yeah. What do you say are some of your most memorable moments of being with this legendary collective?
Oh, man, it's so many, bro. Like, I would say, like, making a Gang Forever mixtape at that studio in Emeryville when we did Never Going Broke. And a Young Kehlani was in there. Just all the guys was in there. That Wiz Khalifa tour, that Under the Influence of Music tour. Game changer. And that, like, shout out to Wiz, like, for giving me that opportunity that took me to a whole nother level. And then probably, like, going on David Letterman and Jimmy Kimmel with Sage was epic. Going on Arsenio Hall was epic. So, yeah, it was, like, it's too many memories as far as bro, I can't forget the HBK days. Crazy. I did this thing with Revolt where I hopped on a tour bus and I went to, like, four different high schools. And it was just like pulling up to them schools was crazy. Like the fan love was through the roof. So like, man, HBK gang, bro, that's forever. But yeah, those times, those 2013, 14 times, whew, man, bro.
Unforgettable.
Unforgettable, bro. It's like, wow. Like, felt like I was an NSYNC or something. Like, for real, though, we was like, I've been chased.
You did.
Like,
you guys had a run. You had a great run.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. For sure, we did. Excellent run, bro. And now it's like a bunch of solo artists out of the clique is still doing well, so we good.
Hilo, Cool John.
Yeah, hell yeah. Yep, Cool John, yep.
A lot of big things that you've accomplished this far in 2013, 2014. Like I said, the last year for those real artists that come out and do their thing, and it's always great to see that they're still working, such as yourself with California Deluxe, man.
Yeah, bro, like 10 years later, so it's like still here, still hungry, still excited, so yeah, hell yeah, bro.
What's left for you to accomplish, man? What's something that's your top goal here?
Man, I got a bunch of goals, bro. Acquiring, like, more land, like, so I definitely want to build, like, some compounds around, like, creativity and, like, retail and stuff. Continue throwing my music festival, I Am Summer. More tech space. Like, I'm working with this app called Dot Wave, which is, like, for independent artists and, like, helping them get the exposure that they need. Man, NFTs. Man, it's hella stuff, bro. But I'm hopping in that metaverse, bro. So just, you know.
Yeah. I do, and that's amazing. I do want your thoughts on the whole Young Dolph thing that happened with him getting killed because rappers are just such a target, and it's a shame because you guys just can't go on and succeed without the greed and envy and hate. But your thoughts on that, and, you know, just for rappers to stay safe out here.
Man, just rest in peace to him, and I gotta just send my love to all his loved ones, people dealing with that loss. I was definitely a fan of his music. My advice to rappers, it's tough. Like, you just gotta stay safe. I mean, trust your instincts. That'll probably be number one. Whenever you feel like, listen to that little voice in you. And don't be so readily available, like my grandma would say.
That's right.
But
that's
definitely right. Rest in peace to Young Dolph. That was sad loss just for the whole hip hop.
Yeah. It doesn't end. Nipsey Hussle, Chinx. It just,
man, yeah, man. Rest in peace to Chinx Drugs. Nipsey. Yeah. Nipsey was definitely somebody who was real cool. Every time I interacted with him, he was cool. Chinx Drugs. I got multiple songs with Chinx Drugs, so, you know.
How was it working with him? Because he's someone that I personally was a fan of, because this man, New York City loved Chinx, because he was on that real hip-hop time.
Yeah, he was hella chill, so, like, it was a period of time where I would be like, I had a couple songs of French Montana, like off the strength of Molly Mall. So being around French and Molly Mall, I met Chinx, and then me and Chinx was the ones that really got cool. So he'll text me, check on me. I'll see him in a club. Like, old school greenhouse New York days. You know what I'm saying? I would see him and like Jim Jones and guys like that. And they would show me love outside. So yeah, me and Chinx, I did that. I hopped on that Feelings remix. And yeah, he hopped on a song called FTB of mine. And he was just cool as hell. And it was hella sad. Hearing he passed away, I was just like, damn, because I'm like, bro, we just now really locking in, you know? So it was just unfortunate we didn't get to do more work.
Yeah, it's insane the amount of rappers that I've talked to and just hearing their stories of being just shot at and shot even and surviving. It's just, and I've heard rappers describe it as being in the middle of a war. And it's just insane. You guys shouldn't have to go through that because that's the whole point. You know, when you make it out and you want to be successful and you want to get away from all that. And it's like, it's sometimes for certain rappers, it's just impossible for them. And it's even when they're showing love. I mean, Young Dolph was showing love to the cookie shop down there. Mm-hmm. And he was getting cookies from his mother and he's getting shot. It's just
despicable. Yeah, you never know. You can't take the good times for granted because it could always change. But like, as far as being in a war, I don't feel like I'm in a war. I feel like it's just an overall war outside, like a spiritual war. So it's just always good and evil. So you just got to keep your eyes open, you know? And like I was saying before, just trust your instincts. And I pick my spots. I'm not always on the road. People be always inviting me out to stuff and trying to do stuff, but I curve certain things, you know what I'm saying? Like, and sometimes it's cool to just post up in the house. I got my microphone in the house. I'd just be staying low most of the time.
Yeah. There's a war going on outside. No man is safe from, as Mobb Deep said once.
Facts. Big facts. Nobody is special in that sense. So you just got to keep your eyes open, bro. That's number one. But uh-huh. God is good. You know what I'm saying? So we're just going to stay blessed.
Yeah. I am Sue. Is there anything else you'd love to let the audience know, your fans know, your listeners know, upcoming visuals, anything that you have coming planned out? I know you got some things with Lil Jon rolling out. Anything else? Yeah.
Man, a bunch of new music. Make sure you hit the eyesonmestore.com. That's T-H-E, eyesonmestore.com. I got my Christmas album, Eyes on Me Christmas. It's available everywhere. Make sure y'all grab that for the holiday season. And yep, California Deluxe, bro. I appreciate you having me on your show.
No doubt, man. Let them know, too, where they can follow you on Instagram at I Am Sue and all that, TikTok, all your platforms, Twitter.
Yeah, so on social media, Twitter and Instagram is at I Am Sue. That's I-A-M-S-U. On TikTok, it's Heartbreak Susie, spelled S-U-Z-Y. So Heartbreak Susie, make sure you hit me up on there. YouTube, the HBK gang. And I got an I Am Sue page. So I'm going to start doing YouTube vlogs on. Make sure you follow them. And yeah, that's pretty much it. That's the whole rundown.
Yeah.
Oh, SoundCloud. I Am Sue SoundCloud. I'll be dropping freestyles all the time. So make sure you like it on there.
Still dropping stuff on SoundCloud.
Yeah, I'm never giving SoundCloud up. It's a wave. That's a wave on
there. Oh, it's amazing to see the real ones still on there instead of all the young artists that are just dropping toxic on there. Garbage. But it's great to see that there's some good artists on there still.
So appreciate that, bro. Oh,
man. I Am Sue. I want to thank you again for coming on the show. I had a great time. You're welcome on the show. Anytime you need any promo, you just let me know and I'll be in contact with your management, and shout out to them for setting this up, and have a happy Thanksgiving too, man.
Salute to you, bro. Happy Thanksgiving. Happy holidays, bro.
You too, man. Enjoy the rest of your night, man. Take care and stay safe.